Hi everyone, my name is Julia and I'm one of the educators here at Ripley's Aquarium of Canada. And today I'll be talking to you about one of our most shocking animals on exhibit, the electric eel. Meet our very own electric eel, Alessandro Volta, named after the Italian physicist and inventor of the battery. Little known fact, electric eels don't actually belong to the eel family. They are a type of knife fish and are more closely related to catfish and carp than to eels themselves. They got their names from their physical resemblance to eels. Lacking pelvic and dorsal fins, they use a reduced caudal fin and an elongated anal fin to guide themselves through the water. These creatures can swim forwards, backwards, or hover in the water column to scope out prey. They can grow up to 8 feet in length and weigh around 45 pounds. Electric eels live across South America and are commonly found in countries like Brazil, the Guianas, Suriname, Venezuela, Colombia, Ecuador, and Peru. They thrive in slow-moving, dark, muddy waters of lakes, mild streams, pools, and the flooded forests of the Amazon and the Orinoco rivers. The vital, non-electric organs of the electric eel make up only 1/5 of their body and are positioned directly behind their head. So the big question is, how do they shock? Well, they actually have unique organs for this special skill. There are 3 specialized organs that make up about 80% of the eel's composition: the mane, the hunter, and the Sachs organ. Within these organs, there are hundreds of thousands of specialized muscle cells called electrocytes. These flattened, disc-shaped cells are stacked within the walls of the eel's body, with about 70 columns on each side. Nerve fibers are attached to one side of each electrocyte. When the eel chooses to shock, a signal is sent down the nervous system and creates a positively charged gradient of sodium ions within the cell, yielding a discharge of electricity. This creates a biological battery and now has positively and negatively charged sides to the cells. The voltage from each cell is small and allows the animal to use an array of shocks. Simultaneous discharges of energy allow the eel to produce up to 650 volts. That's pretty strong, especially considering that North American outlets only supply about 120 volts. Let's take a look at our very own Alessandro's home and his friends. Even though electric eels are relatively solitary animals, here he has a group of friends to keep him company. These Colombian and Amber tetras are perfect roommates because they are actually too small to be affected by his shocks. In order to be electrocuted, a current with a positive and negative wave needs to pass through. The tetras are too small for a current that large. Only a positive or negative wave can pass at a time. Knifefish have very poor eyesight and rely on something called electroreception to navigate the waters. Electroreception is a very cool sense that humans do not have. The eels will emit a weak electric signal and use it both as a radar and to communicate with others. Electroreception is not particularly unique to the electric eel. Sharks, rays, paddlefish, and sturgeon use it too. Electric eels are carnivores that eat small fish, crustaceans, insects, and small vertebrates. If they detect nearby prey, the electric eel will release 2 quick electric pulses called a doublet. This wave causes involuntary muscle spasms in the prey to exhaust them. The eel then sends a rapid fire of high voltage pulses up to 400 volts per second, completely paralyzing the prey. Our husbandry team works very hard to enrich the animal's everyday life by maintaining a consistent dietary pattern, keeping the animals stimulated and the daily care of the exhibit's environment. The electric eel gets fed 4 times a week with freshwater fish, saltwater fish, shrimp, and baby mice. This alternating food schedule ensures that he gets all the nutrients he needs and keeps the feeds exciting. As a part of our enrichment program, our aquarists are practicing target training with Alessandro. They will ring a dinner bell to send vibration signals before they feed him, which helps condition his relation to the sounds and receiving food. This will help the animal care team with future physicals, as he will associate the bell with a positive interaction and will be willing to come up to the surface when needed. Electric eels are incredibly nearsighted, so this sound and vibration helps alert him that it is time to feed. This bad eyesight doesn't affect how they find food in the Amazon, as its water clarity can only be a couple of inches at a time. Electric eels also use their shocks as warning pulses to keep potential predators at bay. This results in water animals not usually willing to try preying on electric eels in fear of knowing the full force of their shock. Additionally, water is an excellent conductor of electricity and provides a large surface area for their shock to be distributed. However, during the dry season, electric eels can find themselves in situations where they are vulnerable to predators due to shallow water levels. Larger land animals that the eels usually would not need to worry about sometimes try their luck. While the eel's shock is mostly for defense and acts as a warning, they can be forced to use it offensively to fend off predators from above the water. If deemed necessary, electric eels have been seen to leap from the water to make direct contact with their predators and target their shocks with increasing voltages. While electric eels have a status of least concern in terms of endangerment, it is important that we work to preserve their homes. About 1 in 10 of Earth's known species inhabit the Amazon, making it a very diverse ecosystem. It also comprises about 1.6 billion acres of forest and holds about half the world's remaining tropical forests and 20% of the world's fresh water. The Amazon is threatened by mass deforestation, influencing longer and hotter dry seasons. This leads to withered crops, decline in fishery production, forest fires, and eventually loss of species. Experts say that deforestation should not exceed 20% of the region to avoid irreversible damage. However, currently the Amazon is sitting at about 17%. This vast habitat is crucial in our battle against climate change. The humid environment releases large amounts of water vapor into the atmosphere, generating rainfall in the wet seasons, which is essential for agricultural production in Southern America. On top of that, the forests absorb billions of tons of carbon dioxide, which work to slow down climate change globally. There are current initiatives working towards a more sustainable future to preserve the environment. For instance, the Amazon Region Protected Areas, or ARPA, program cares for 154 million acres of forest. Between 2008 and 2020, ARPA has saved 1,000 square miles of land from deforestation, preventing over 100 million tons of CO2 emissions. So how can we as Canadians help? Although the Amazon is far from Canada, we can do our part to help combat climate change in a variety of ways. For instance, buying locally sourced products when possible to cut down on environmental impact. In Ontario, we have access to a wide variety of food resources such as fruits, vegetables, and livestock. Thank you for tuning in. I'm elated to be spreading the word about these unique animals with all of you. Be sure to swim by the gallery and give Alessandro a wave.